In the early hours of January 12, 1975, in Braddock Park in North Bergen, New Jersey, a local store owner, George Obarski, was in his car when the radio suddenly filled with static. Around the same time, a doorman from the nearby Stonehenge Apartments reported seeing strange, floating lights. Obarski would later on go to describe the fantastic encounter he had that night in an interview with known UFO investigator Bud Hopkins. Obarski recounted how he had seen an object seemingly 30 feet long and floating only 6 feet above the ground. The object landed, and humanoid figures emerged from the craft and seemed to collect samples of soil from the ground of the park and then re-embark on the craft as it lifted back into the air. Obarski said he returned to the site hours later and was amazed to find holes exactly where the creatures had been. New Jersey is no stranger to UFO sightings, and almost exactly to the day 6 years prior to Mr. Obarski's encounter, it would seem UFOs had visited in search of something else besides Earth, just over 20 miles to the northeast, over the Wanaque, New Jersey Reservoir. This case file joined the theorists as they garble some Garden State accents in the Wanaque UFO Incident.
Welcome to Alien Theorist Theorizing, Case File 164, Wanaque, New Jersey, Reservoir UFO Incident Report. I couldn't remember where it stops. It's all that. It's the longest name ever. I'm Braden.
I'm Zell.
I'm Dan.
And I'm Andrew.
Woo! Wanaque. Boys are back in town. And we're going to be slumming it in New Jersey.
Jersey.
For this week's case file. All right, well, let's get right into this with the Wanaque UFO incident.
Back on a little UFO.
Yeah, I'm not 100% sure, actually, how to pronounce this, because I have heard it a couple different ways while I was researching this.
Wanaque.
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 Wanaque, New Jersey.
I thought it was Wanaque, but...
I thought it was Wanoque.
Could have been Wanoque.
I thought it was a Wanaque.
Wanaque. That's what I thought it was Wanaque.
So there seems like there's multiple ways which
you mean we could have called this one the Crashy at Wanaque.
Change the name.
Yeah, I don't think we would have been wrong. I think
restart. Restart the show.
We could have supported that one.
Do over.
So this particular UFO incident occurred January 11th, 1966, at around 6:30 p.m. The sun had already gone down, so it's 6:30 January. You can imagine it's early evening and it's probably pretty dark at this point. You're going to have a lot of witnesses for this case because there were a lot of people that were witness to the events that happened on this particular night. So keeping all the names straight is a little bit difficult, but that's why we kind of, this one is so interesting, is that you had almost an entire town witnessing what happened this night.
It actually blew me away that we have just, like, this is the first time when you brought it up, I looked into this. I'd never heard about this case, but like, we're talking like policemen, military personnel, firefighters, mayors, councilmen, their kids, you know, rogue teenagers, mothers, daughters, store owners, like the whole, like you were saying, the whole town.
Cats, dogs,
everybody.
Store owners, grandmas, grandpas, second cousins.
Every single person and their grandma saw this thing and had an account. So it's not like you just have like the town kook who saw it. You have all these people who are credible people.
What a missed opportunity. Like, come on now. You could have merchandised the shit out of this. This could have been New Jersey's fucking Charlie Red Star.
Yeah, well, it's funny. Funny you say that. They do, you know, it could have been that, but it is also called New Jersey's Roswell.
Well, any UFO encounter in a place ends up being called that place as Roswell.
Yeah, that Roswell. So this is the New Jersey Roswell incident.
Jersey.
So one of the very first witnesses is Wanaque patrolman Joseph Cisco, who was in his police cruiser at the time, and he got a call from the area of Pompton Lakes. The dispatcher came over the radio and gave a report of some sort of glowing light was occurring, and they were the general thought was that it was a fire, so he needed to go, and they wanted people to go and out and check it out. And then Cisco recalled that he heard over the rest of the radio, he heard people from the areas of Oakland, Ringwood, Patterson, Totowa, and or Totowa. Not sure. It's like, New Jersey has a bunch of fucking weird ass name towns. I don't know.
Like, how does it feel, Dan?
it's not easy. I'm pulling a Braden tonight. But yeah, you had all these people reporting that there is a flying saucer over the town of Wanaque. So Cisco goes on to recall that he actually witnessed this light when he got a chance to see it, and it looked bigger than any of the stars. Seemed to be about he judged it to be about the size of a softball or a volleyball. He described it as pulsating, a white light. That seemed to be changing from white to red. It stayed in the air, and he recalls there being no noise.
I think he actually had a key witness in this situation, didn't you, Braden? You got a good statement from somebody for it?
Yeah, I think he went, and it kind of went something like this. Good afternoon. My name is Officer Cisco. I am but a humble officer of the law.
Hey, oh, I'm walking here.
I am just wondering if you happen perchance to see anything out of the ordinary tonight.
Hey, first of all here, let's get this out right away here. I ain't no stinking rat, see? So don't come around here asking me these questions, sounding like some kind of fugazi cop over here, all right? Because you ain't gonna hear nothing. Forget about it, all right? Capiche?
I just wanted to know if you had seen anything out of the ordinary.
Maybe. Oh, you mean the light?
Oh, so you're telling me you saw a light.
I mean, I saw a light. It was bright. Now let me tell you something. This is the brightest thing I've ever seen in my entire life, all right? And all of a sudden, this light, it's over here. It's over there. It's fucking green. It's fucking red. Bada bing, bada boom. It's fucking everywhere.
So what you're trying to tell me is that this light zigzagged across the night sky.
Hey, I'm not trying to fucking tell you nothing here, all right? I'm not telling you nothing, capiche? Forget about it. Nothing happened.
Okay, my apologies, good sir. And I will let you on your way if that is all you in fact did see.
I mean, I did see some giant holes in some ice looking, you know, we're talking sizes of pizza pies here. But hey, you're good, you. You're good with that smooth voice here. You're good. I can see what you're doing here, and it's not going to fucking work.
I think Cisco was actually a Southern law enforcement officer that had transferred in from somewhere, some, you know, New
from
Orleans.
From South Jersey. He's from South Jersey.
That's Braden and Andrew representing the wonderful diversity of New Jersey accents.
Yeah, he's from South Jersey.
Well, I think South that's Jersey. That sounds right to me.
You couldn't find, you had to get a way to get that voice back in for another episode of Cajun Justice, is what you're saying?
I think that's he's this stuck isn't on that Cajun, setting now. I think he's stuck on that accent.
This isn't Cajun Justice. Now. This is New Jersey Justice.
But you haven't heard anybody from South Jersey before? That is fucking bang on.
I'm going to say it's in the realms of possibilities because I don't know anyone from South Jersey. So if you can sit here and look me dead in the eye and say there's not a single person in New Jersey that talks like that, I will apologize.
Okay, sure.
So other than our Southern gentleman, Joseph
Southern
Cisco.
Southern New Jersey gentleman.
Southern New Jersey gentleman, Joseph Cisco.
That's the show. The show is called The Jersey Gentleman.
Woo, I like it.
Fuck, TLC, sign us up.
Do it.
That'll be a hit. Comes around. What is 90 Day Fiance? Is that on TLC?
Yeah.
Yeah, comes okay. right it on. Comes right after t- comes yeah, right after 90 Day Fiancé.
It actually comes in the middle between, you know, the 36 episodes into 90 Day Fiancé. It breaks up with a quick half hour of Jersey Gentleman.
So you actually had people like the actual mayor of Wanaque, Harry T. Wolf. You also had council members, city council members, Warren Hagstrom and Arthur Burton.
Harry Wolf. That's a fucking great name.
And you had the mayor's 14-year-old son, Billy, who actually were on their way to oversee the burning of the borough's Christmas trees at the time. And then they had actually heard the reports. It seems like everybody
hates Christmas in New Jersey. They're just burning trees all over the place.
Well, Christmas is over.
It says January 11th.
Yeah. What are you supposed to do with the trees?
Brayden's that guy who keeps his Christmas tree up all year. So he doesn't have to put it up the following year.
I just thought this was an attack on Christmas when I first read it. I was like, what does New Jersey have against Christmas?
City of Grinches. Trees fucking everywhere. City of Grinches.
It's really strange that they have all these people reporting that they heard these actual police reports, because I feel like everybody at some point in the 60s, I think like everybody owned a police scanner. I wonder if that was a thing. Like I know I've never owned one. I know some people, I think I have neighbors that own them.
Well, I think this is like, I don't know how small this town was, but like I gather it's quite small, because Cisco, not only was he fucking a cop, but he was also the fire chief. And you know what I mean? Like, I think these guys, you know, there's fucking.
Yeah, I assume the mayor would have one. Like the mayor would probably want one. So he'd probably keep one in his car at that point.
It's probably just not like a trap, it's probably an open, at this time, it's probably like open radio. Probably if you have a CB radio, you could probably just tune in.
Yeah, I mean, like, they've now, how long has it been since they started digitizing the fucking radios now so people can't get on them? It hasn't been that long. Like, I used to have a police scanner app on my phone. This was, like, not even that, like, maybe 5 years ago.
Maybe this is some sort of, like, Neighborhood Watch Alliance fucking thing.
Everyone's got access.
Well, I assume that if you're the mayor of the town, you would want a police scanner, or you would have something to listen to.
Keep out all those crusty jugglers.
Crusty jugglers.
For the greater good.
Maybe Harry T. Wolf is a fucking part-time superhero. Mayor, superhero, has got a fucking police scanner fighting crime.
Little vigilante justice.
Just like Adam West.
Either way.
The Jersey Devil.
Very quickly, like every fucking Tom, Dick, and Harry in town knew that there's something going on at the reservoir.
Yep.
So the people who saw this light, flying oddly over this frozen lake, which was formed by the reservoir at the time. Probably the most exciting or the climax of the event is when this object seemed to fire down or emanate a cone shape of light down towards the ground into the ice, or it seemed to project it onto the ice. And there were reports of people saying that it was burning holes in the ice,
hovering above the reservoir, shooting a laser beam into the ice.
Right. So there was that. That was one of the things that Joseph Cisco recalled hearing over the radio, is somebody reporting that something is burning a hole in the ice.
And in some of the like readings, they would say like perfect holes,
right? Like a laser precise, perfect melt hole.
Yeah.
Shaped like pizza pies.
Right. So very strange. Something that I haven't encountered in all of our case files.
No, I mean, when I first read this one, what was that one we did not that long ago with this? It was kind of the same.
Coming down on the lake with the people on the dock.
Well, yeah, well, that's the same kind of
one at the dam,
floating orb. Yeah.
Buff Ledge.
That one with the bulls?
Buff Ledge. Yeah. That was the one where it came down, but that one, it didn't shoot a beam, but it like floated above a lake and then ended up.
Well, there was a beam though, remember? Because it was like an X-ray.
Yeah,
Yes, yeah, that's right. Woo! So similar
very,
to that.
Very similar. The other thing that was weird about this one is that like some of the descriptions of it is that like it would like bend the treetops and stuff towards it, almost like if it was affecting gravity or something, or like had some sort of suction force going on when it was like hovering
towards
over the trees.
It? So like, it's not all like the a propulsion?
All the trees would like bend like towards it. Like when it was going over top. I thought that was interesting. I read that in one of the articles that were going to, not really stuck with me. I went, well, that's very interesting.
That's weird.
That would something would do that.
Well, if you go with it, if it's an actual UFO, and they always say like they're not like propelling themselves through space, they're like folding space. So like the yeah. like the it's like reversing gravity or something. So maybe that would explain stuff.
Folding shifting, space.
The other
yeah, folding space. The fuck? Shifting space.
It's, like, it's like how you fold the cheese.
Well, just like that.
And then you, yeah, and then you poke a hole through the cheese and through, you're on the boom. Other side.
Space travel in a nutshell. Space travel for dummies.
It's, yeah, it was sucking treetops together. And another report here that Sergeant Ben Thompson reported, he said that it would cause a rise in the reservoir's water level when it was above it. So it's almost like some affecting gravity, like pulling it up towards it, which is very interesting.
Well, this one is the water frozen though? Is the water frozen?
Well, I'm guessing if it's a reservoir, there's a dam or something.
Yeah.
Right. So maybe there's frozen on one side, but where it runs out,
Moving faster.
Yeah, moving faster. It hasn't quite frozen.
Right.
That's what I'm guessing. This is coming from Sergeant Ben Thompson. This is his account.
Or could it be trying to like suck shit up? You know what I mean? Like, what if it's like a Dr. Robotnik situation where he's trying to steal all these like fucking creatures and turn them into evil robots?
Well, it begs the question of like, okay, well, why is it melting holes in the ice if it's looking or if it's trying to suck up water, sucking up fish. Something from the water, right? Maybe it's not sucking up, but maybe it's sucking something up on like a different dimensional plane that we can't even see or perceive, but we can see the physical, you know, I fucking lost words, but we can see the holes in the lights in our dimension, but whatever it's doing, it's on a different wavelength than what we can perceive.
Can't perceive.
Or maybe
it.
It's pulling shit up on like a molecular level. That
exactly.
Too
yeah.
Small
exactly.
For us to see. Right. Okay. Yeah. 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 I'm picking up what you're putting down.
So you had other people, like you had Councilman Warden Hagstrom, who was a witness to this. And, you know, at first when they saw this object, they thought it was some type of helicopter, but they noticed the absolute lack of noise. There was no sound of a motor. There is, you know, but he said it resembled a helicopter in some way. He described it having these big landing lights, but it was just something about it that must have rubbed him the wrong way, because he said that he remembers getting goosebumps when they saw like where that hole was, you know, that there was a hole in the ice, and it's just like there's nothing that can do that. If it was some type of helicopter, like that light would, there's nothing really that could do that, or that they know that could do that.
And they also say if it's a helicopter, all the witnesses say it was silent.
Yeah, right. Exactly. So there's no sound coming from this object, but it was still moving. There was a noticeable movement. Some people described it moving in a type of pattern, like up and down, back, forth, up, down. It was moving in what seemed to be some type of, you know, intelligent pattern as it moved through the sky.
If it's like a predictable pattern, it's like it's moving in a way like that's how it is. Because if it's moving in a predictable pattern, repeating over and over, is that what they're saying? Like I just kept doing like the same left, right, up, down.
Well, if it was moving in some type of pattern, I mean, from that, you could kind of, I guess you could come to the conclusion that it was perhaps some kind of search pattern, that it was looking for something.
Which is interesting because, yeah. Like, right away in my head when I read this part, I was in my head, I was like, okay, well, what could I relate that to now? What in my head? And I just went drone, like some sort of drone.
Right.
But this is 1966. We didn't have anything like this, let alone silent in the air. Right?
Because they said they're saying it's not bigger, that it's not more than like, what they're saying, like 3 or 4 feet or something.
Right. Most of the reports that they said it didn't seem to be that large, like at least the light itself or the object from where the beams of light were emanating. Most of the people said it was, they estimated it being maybe 2 to 3 feet across.
Yeah, but isn't it like when you don't, like something's in the sky like that and you don't have anything to like compare it to, it's got to be so fucking hard to actually give a good estimate of the size.
Yes. Especially if it's dark out and you're staring up into a light, the light could be, or the object could be 5 feet, like 5 feet across, but only like 50 feet up. Or it could be, you know, it could be a 200 foot object, but it could be 1,000 feet up. But if it's just like a bright light, it'd be hard to judge distance.
Totally. So it's up there. It's bright. It's moving like the fucking organized, looks like the Konami code fucking bouncing around up there. What else is going on?
Melted holes in the ice, and then
melted holes in the ice. This seemed to go on for about half an hour, and then it took off. They noted the direction is southeast. It seemed to hover briefly over one of the regional high schools, Lakeland Regional High School. It seems that people reported that it had reappeared over some other areas. People noted the Houndale sand pit in Haskell, where people were burning Christmas trees, where their volunteer firemen were burning Christmas trees. So maybe that was something it wanted to check out.
Interesting. More Christmas trees.
And then at least they're not crossing. Continued
all right.
Southeast, kept going in the direction of Pine Lakes and Wayne, New Jersey, which I checked. That is Fountains of Wayne, Stacy's mom.
Oh, shit. That guy, the lead singer, just died. R.I.P.
So was there anything else that happened on this January 11th date?
So from that, Joseph Sisko would report seeing that bright light appear one more time. And he said that this occurred at 4 a.m., you know, on the morning of the next day. So, you know, it moved from the night of January 11th to the morning of January 12th.
All right. Before we talk more about Joseph Sisko, let's take a quick beer break. We'll be right back.
So we were talking about Joseph Sisko, who was one of the first people to have seen this UFO. And then he actually re-encountered perhaps this very same UFO at 4 a.m. the next morning. So you had all the events of the previous night happening around 6:30 to 7. And then you had this another reappearance of another UFO at 4 a.m. And he remarked, or he recalls, this object moving from north to south along the horizon over the town of Wyckoff. So that was another time to see it. This wouldn't be the last time that these people would see this UFO, which also makes this case very fascinating, is that you see this UFO multiple times and you have multiple witnesses seeing it. So not only that morning would you see it, but then there would be another reports of another bright white disc reported to have been seen by patrolman Jack Wardlaw and seeing this in the vicinity of his home in Stonetown, Wanaque, and he remarked on this thing appearing to be about 1,000 feet up, like as far as it was. He is quoted saying that it wasn't any helicopter, a plane, or a comet. It shot laterally, left to right. It stopped, moved up straight, and then it moved down and then disappeared in the direction of Ringwood, which is to the north. So he describes the actual shape of this, while a lot of the other reports just reported seeing some type of a small object with the, you know, bright light, or at least just the bright light itself. He actually described this, giving it a shape, assigning it a disc shape, and then it seemed from certain angles to appear even egg-shaped at times.
Right. So just, we had the sightings the first night, next morning.
Well, this is like a 24-hour flap, essentially.
Yeah. Right.
Right? Like this over the course of 2 days, you were continuously seeing strange lights, you know, of varying degree. And this goes with all the people's accounts in the town. Of all the people who see it, there's varying degrees of like people seeing it, you know, like this, just a light in the sky. That's odd. Maybe some maneuvers. You have people seeing it blasting holes in ice, really shining, changing colors, like unbelievable experience. And then you have people who are just like, yeah, I saw some like repeating light, but there was nothing like there's such a wide variety of accounts from this these 24 hours based on when people saw it and kind of where they saw it.
It goes from like War of the Worlds type alien invasion to swamp gas.
Yeah, essentially.
Like how the range of sightings goes. But yeah, it's a flap, a 24 hour flap. I don't know. It's a cool one.
I think like looking into it, the other thing that really interests me is that the amount of people that were like, it was so amazing that, you know, in January, I don't know how cold it is there, but there's cold enough that the lake's frozen, that all these people are jumping in their cars and heading up to where this thing could possibly be to try to get a sight of it.
Like jamming the highways, like parking on the side of the shoulder of the highway, getting out, looking for it.
Yeah, they had to actually secure the gates. Like the reservoir security guard had to actually secure the gates to keep people from coming up onto the reservoir to get a closer look at this object as it was hovering over the frozen lake itself.
I mean, what else is on TV in 1966 in New Jersey? Probably nothing better to do. Might as well fucking go have a look.
Well, and like, not only that, but like, there's also, they've like, the phone lines for the police are jammed up as they were getting like hundreds of calls about this thing. So it's like, it's just very interesting to me that like the amount of people that, you know, had seen this and then we never heard about it. Like it's called like one of the greatest mass UFO sightings, like never talked about or never told. And it really is like there's so much to this case and there's so many people who saw it.
Yeah, exactly.
Right. And yeah, and there's so many people who saw it. So then that kind of brings the question to, did anybody document this? Did anybody take any photos? Because really most of this stuff goes off of just straight up accounts from the witnesses of the event itself. So you have a lot of that. Now it's 1966. I don't expect everybody to have any pictures of this, but later on down the road, even today, if you search for Wanaque, you spell it right. So if you're looking at this podcast and you look at the title and you type it in, a certain photo will come up that is associated with this sighting and is alleged to be the picture of the object, as it's projecting its light or its beam onto the ground at the time that evening of January 11th.
Is the ground, or is it the one burning the hole in the ice?
I'm not sure if it's burning the hole in the ice. Like, I'm not sure if that's the actual picture, but this photo itself.
I would assume that it's one of the ones from up on the, from the water, because those are mainly where you get all the reports of that bright shining light down onto the frozen lake. You don't really get accounts of that anywhere else. So I would say it's pretty safe assumption that picture is probably from there. And based on the amount of people that were at the dam, I would imagine that you could say that that's probably the location of this picture.
Right. So if you know about this photo, like the first question you're going to ask yourself is, who took this photo? Okay, so it was reported to have been taken by, I think, a co-worker of Cisco's who wanted to remain anonymous when they first published this photo. Then the story gets a little bit more interesting. It's reported by the periodical the publication that printed this photo, that the negatives had been taken by Project Blue Book investigators.
Ooh,
cover up.
Here we go.
So this gets into the side of what another interesting aspect of this sighting is that you have there seem to be attempts to cover up or, you know, deny the occurrence that happened that January evening. So after midnight, or shortly after midnight, after the first sightings, there came word from Stewart Air Force Base in Newburgh, New York, that an Air Force helicopter with a powerful beacon of some type had actually been on some type of mission at the same time that the UFO is spotted. So you have this first report. This is just shortly after midnight, after these sightings had happened, maybe, you know, a couple hours after the first initial sightings had happened, you get this report of a helicopter, you know, making it a possible suspect or explanation for what was happening. But then at 6:15 that morning, the official spokesman for Stewart Air Force Base, Major Donald Sherman, denied that any aircraft had been on any mission that night. That this explanation of a helicopter was completely unfounded. That pretty much whoever said that never happened.
Liar. That's bullshit. Never happened. No helicopter. We don't have anything like that.
Wait, so when did they say it was a helicopter? Just like immediately after the event was happening?
This was shortly after midnight. That night, right after the first sightings.
So a representative from the Air Force Base got hold of the media and there's like, yeah, it's just, we just got a helicopter with a powerful beacon. And then they were like, what's the beacon for?
They're getting, you know, the police are probably ill-equipped to handle something in the sky. So they're taking calls. And I imagine that gets forwarded to some sort of like military or something that has the capability of like, hey, we have something in our airspace here that we don't know that shoot beams. Everyone's freaking the fuck out. What the hell? What's going on here? And that would be the kind of why the military might release this statement like, oh, don't worry about it. It's just one of our, we're doing a training mission. It's all good.
So they're just trying to like quell the public just with a quick, it's a helicopter. No, don't worry about it.
Yeah, even though we're, you know, there's not one single report of people hearing the blades or hearing the helicopter. This thing's perfectly silent.
And then 6 hours later, you have them completely flip the narrative and then be like, no, there was no such thing. That never happened.
And not only was the helicopter silent or whatever, or the object silent, it also was melting holes in the ice.
So do we know who the representative was that announced that it was a helicopter initially and then fucking retracted it? Like,
no, there's just
a blanket.
It just
report.
Seems that it is probably like passed down through the line. Like, I'm sure somebody had called probably Stewart Air Force Base. Like, hey, are you guys doing anything? Cause I'm sure that would be one of the first things you'd kind of want to call. You'd probably call the local airports. You'd call, you know, whoever has, and then Air Force, like you just call them like, do you guys have anything going on? Right now,
stupid question.
If anything in there,
but like, does every single fucking city in the United States have a military or Air Force base? Because I feel like every time we talk about an alien fucking case, they all have fucking Air Force bases.
There's always an Air Force base around. Always,
like it's the same fucking story. It's this shit's all the same.
I want to Google real quick. How many Air Force bases are in this U.S.?
Listen, quite a few. You're always just a quick flight away from an Air Force base.
Apparently.
So now you have this, these two, you know, opposing narratives happening that there was a helicopter, there's not a helicopter. Well, then the Pentagon gets involved and then they said that the mystery object actually was a helicopter.
And just to interject for timing's sakes, the 24 hours after the whole it's a helicopter, it's not a helicopter debacle, the Pentagon is then like, you know what? Actually, it was a helicopter with a powerful beacon. The first report was right. Yeah.
Flip the script
completely again.
Well, they didn't give the fucking memo to the day shift is the problem. But he walks in the day and be like, what the fuck are you talking about? We don't know anything about a helicopter. You guys are fucking crazy. And then he gets the memo from the Pentagon being like, oh, you mean that helicopter? Yeah. It's definitely a helicopter.
And there's 59 active Air Force bases in the U.S., yeah. So yeah, you're just no matter where you are, there's always one not
there's
far
always
away.
One. So then you have McGuire Air Force Base in Wrightstown, New Jersey, and they said that this object was a weather balloon that had actually been launched from Kennedy International Airport.
Oh, this sounds familiar.
You had officials from Stewart Air Force Base and McGuire denying any interest in this UFO. They didn't really want anything to do about it, apparently. And that apparently some of the Wanaque police had actually re- reported seeing a pair of jets fly over the reservoir shortly after the UFO had been seen.
Yeah, no shit. I guarantee you they had some shit on radar that they weren't sure, and they scrambled jets.
Well, I bet you if your job is like national defense and you're on the Air Force base and the police get 200 calls that there's an UFO, the first, like, if you're on domestic soil, there's not like a lot of like active action. You guarantee they're throwing the jets up. Like, all right, there might be some excuse to scramble. Let's go.
Yeah. Go.
I could also see some idiot though, like, running the phone boards, and then they ask him what's going on, and then he runs into the, you know, air traffic control and says, like, you know, hey, do we got anything up in the air? And they say, oh yeah, we got this helicopter out there with this really bright light. And he says, oh, okay, he's just trying to be a nice guy. He tries to put people at ease. He says, oh, we had this helicopter, but maybe this helicopter was actually top secret. Then his division officer or whatever gets in there. It's like, what the fuck did you do? You told them about our top secret helicopter, you dumb shit. Like, and then they just said, no, no, there's no helicopter.
I mean, like, that's the thing I don't understand. It's like, even if it was a top secret helicopter, like, what the fuck is going to happen if they're, yeah, it's a helicopter. Okay. Like, oh shit, it was top secret. Everybody that saw it's automatically going to fucking spontaneously.
It's not like this is the first helicopter. We know what fucking helicopters are.
Yeah. Like, I don't know. Well, it's weird.
It's so top secret. That's a helicopter that doesn't make noise and has a melting beam underneath of it. That's
this is a possible scenario. I'm not saying it's actually happened, but I was like, I could see that happening where it's like somebody tries to allay the fears of the populace. They don't want, you know, mass, you know, whatever, hysteria. They don't want a whole bunch of like a panic to set in. So they tell them about this helicopter, and somebody says, and then somebody else higher rank gets in there like, you told him about the helicopter, you dumb fuck. And then the Pentagon gets in there like, well, the cat's already out of the bag, so might as well just tell him it's a helicopter. But
I don't mean to go backwards, but did we get a size on those holes in the ice?
Well, if the craft was, they say
three to four feet, they wouldn't be that big.
Well, I mean, like, we have no fucking clue how big the craft was. We have some guy that's standing on the dam being like, I think it's that big with nothing to compare it to. But like, could they not have measured the fucking holes in the ice though? Like, there's maybe no the record
ice
of that?
Maybe the ice wasn't thick enough or something. Maybe it was like,
you can't walk. You could actually, maybe they
did the same thing with, they're like, oh, that maybe it was 3 to 4 foot hole, but it doesn't actually, no one gives an exact measurement of the hole on the ice, I don't believe.
Hmm. I mean, like, could it just been fucking people ice fishing earlier that day, like, you know what I mean?
Just
like,
conveniently that there's this UFO and someone's augered a hole.
It shines lights in the holes. Like, what's that hole? What's that hole? Yeah, what's that hole?
The helicopter's out there looking for good fucking ice fishing spots. But hey, that's a fucking great looking hole right there.
Again, I don't like the helicopter angle only because of the descriptions of it and how it moved. Now, I would say a drone, but we know they didn't have drones like this in 66.
What about a spotlight?
The other thing is, I, like Dan was saying, like, maybe someone was just like, hey, it's a helicopter. Someone's like, hey, don't say it's like, why would you tell them that? I think it's more of like, oh yeah, we had a help. They're just trying to cover up that they, you know, maybe they did scramble jet. They're trying to cover that up. And then the guy's like, why would you say that we have this helicopter? We don't have that. And if we did, you shouldn't be telling people we have this kind of shit. So we got to say we don't, because we don't have this kind of thing. And you can't release this. And then later they're like, who gives a shit if they think it's a helicopter with a spotlight? Just let's go with that. We already said it. I don't think it's that they actually had this helicopter in there. I don't believe for a second that a helicopter was in the air that night and was causing these people to see this. I don't believe that for a second. There's too many accounts. You would think that there was someone there who had seen a helicopter before and is like, hey, everyone, this is called a helicopter.
Well, when did helicopters actually start though? Like, didn't they start using helicopters in the Vietnam War?
I mean, helicopters had been around since World War II, but they hadn't been fully like, you know, using military helicopters, like the first like aerial cavalry, like the Bell Huey and those ones, like the Huey Bell, whatever, like those ones didn't come around till later. Like
the helicopter flight was 1939.
Yeah. So helicopters have been around for a long time.
And I guess we're at the start. This is like the start of the Vietnam War, isn't it? Mid 60s. We're going off topic here, but I'm saying like people might have seen those helicopters by now. It might have been, it's in public domain. People know about those helicopters.
Yeah, people know about helicopters. I'm gonna assume Vietnam War
started about, well, technically it started in 1955, but I don't think the U.S. got U.S. didn't get involved until later.
So either way, the public knows what helicopters are, and if like everyone's heard a helicopter, you can hear that motherfucker flying from so far away.
Yeah, they're fucking loud.
I mean, we don't even, do we have silent helicopters today?
We have very quiet helicopters. We have incredibly quiet ones, but we don't have that we know of. silent helicopters.
Is there any silent choppers that are like big though?
Well, the Apache attack helicopter is actually pretty quiet. Like those things can come over hills like before you even know it. Like, but
once it's over the hill, you know it's coming.
I mean, yeah.
So this is right over people. Yeah,
because then it like unleashes its fucking like mini cannon on you and you're like ripped in half, but yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay, so the explanation of it was a helicopter, then not a helicopter, and then the Pentagon saying it's a helicopter. You're like, okay, sure. Maybe that's the easiest way to quell the public. Like, oh, it's just a helicopter. But
I mean, it gives me very Roswell vibes. It gives me that real,
yeah.
You know,
yep.
It was
that initial, like, we've
no,
got a
it
craft.
Wasn't a UFO. It's nothing to do with the UFO. Ah, it's a weather balloon, or is it a special type of weather balloon?
Well, when they come out and say that, like, isn't it McGuire Air Force Base that says that it's in fact a weather balloon?
Right.
Like, so now there's you got different officials saying it's a weather balloon. Like, to me, when you listen to the accounts that these people have, and then you hear them say it's a weather balloon that was launched, I was like, what kind of fucking balloon? Maybe, you know what? Maybe I shouldn't talk. I've never really seen a weather balloon up close. And maybe it's like an amazing life-changing event because they just dart around the sky. They're fucking shooting holes in ice, pulsating lights. You know, I've actually never seen a weather balloon. So maybe that is in fact what they look like. But I just assume that they don't look like that at all. Because it's a balloon.
They're usually just a big white balloon with a long string at the bottom with the instruments attached. They're a balloon. Like they don't move up and down and sideways just a few hundred feet off the ground. They're meant to go like 70,000 feet in the atmosphere and float there and give back data.
Now, I also had read that it could have been a mixture of, I love this, of, you know, the classic swamp gas and a weather balloon, because something about with the rocks in that area under immense pressure release gas, you know, and Venus comes over and hits the swamp gas ever so perfectly with the weather balloon in the sky, just makes for an unbelievable sight. Like that's very close to something I actually read.
So what you're talking about is that there was an actual company, Vestigia, which is an organization that tried to seek plausible explanations, scientific explanations for unexplained phenomena. Their conclusion was that what they had seen over Wanaque was actually similar to what we talked about in is the Berwyn UFO incident. When we talked about the Berwyn incident in the UK a long time ago or a while ago, it is a result of a type of electrical phenomenon that is produced by the faults in the Earth's crust, and the Ramapo area sits on a type of apparently one of these faults where electrical energy field will actually be produced within the quartz bearing rocks underground. So the immense pressure and things like this will release this electrical discharge into the air and can seem like these. I've never seen this. I mean, scientists
super
have
rare.
It's been observed, but I've never seen
this. This seems
like
this seems ludicrous to me, that explanation, because you would think it would happen more regularly, that people would be like,
but it is exceedingly rare.
Yeah.
It's not something you see all the time.
Well, they have earthquake lights are a thing. If there is a big earthquake, you'll see it's like from like it's static electricity caused from the earthquake. It'll be produced into the atmosphere, and you can see like the earthquake lights are like flashing and shit, but they're not like, it's not like concentrating in a singular point and kind of like floating around. Earthquake lights and stuff like that, when you, because they do happen often, are like an atmospheric, like wide phenomenon. Like you see the flashes and like the energy like bounding around. But as far as like a concentrate, like this is more like a ball lightning, right? Like a small orb of energy.
Right.
It's, but well, remember, I mean, it's yeah. pulsating red, blue, green, white.
You know what's crazy is we've been getting a lot of stories about those color changing UFOs.
Yeah.
Yeah, man.
It's kind of the same thing. Like it's red, it's white, it's blue, it's orange. And it's like, it's going back and forth. It's like a, so this is not the first time we've been getting them recently.
Yeah. This is.
So you know. Two other possible explanations that are put forth for this phenomenon is that, of course, like you said, it's not necessarily Jupiter and Venus, or actually, well, it is, one of them is Jupiter, but not Venus. And that would have possibly been in the correct vicinity to have done something like this or been mistaken
have
for
you
a type
ever
of object.
Gone up and looked at the sky and gone, seen the mirage of Jupiter looking 3 or 4 feet wide and darting around the sky? Like, is that the wave of the gas that makes it appear that it's moving? Like, how does that work?
Well, Jupiter is always like the first star in the sky most of the year. In the northern hemisphere, at least.
It can get quite bright as well.
Yeah, it looks like a bright star, but it's not like, it doesn't look like it's right above you.
So then you have another possible explanation would be the star Sirius, which can also appear quite low in the sky at points, like 24 degrees. And then it is less brilliant, but it is also well known for having the characteristic of multicolored flashes because it does seem to change colors.
Does it move though?
When you look at it. Well, certain atmospheric conditions can affect the way that like the stars, so they can look like they move. Drastic changes, I don't think so much, but there. I've never sat there and stared at something for so long.
It fooled an entire town.
Yeah, I know.
You know what I mean? Like, that's what's crazy to me. It'd be like if it was like two fucking yokels sitting on the back of their trucks drinking a six pack. You know what I mean? I would get it. But a whole fucking town?
Like, and not only wild. This, let's not forget this part too. We do have even a little bit of Men in Black, you know, in this case.
You talking people are making coins disappear?
Yeah, making coins disappear, flashing. People dressed in Air Force uniforms and bearing credentials had actually rounded up some witnesses and had told them, like, listen, you hadn't seen anything and you shouldn't discuss this incident. And, you know, people
assumed
make
any sense. If there was Men in Black, they would have neuralized all of them. So
and
bullshit.
And
bullshit.
They made it assume, like, they made it seem that people just assumed they were from the Air Force. The look, the talk. And then Colonel George P. Freeman, spokesman for Project Blueland or Project Blue Book.
Bluebin.
Bluebin. I was right too far ahead.
Bluebin.
And he like their research that these men had no connection to the Air Force in any way, and they don't know who they were.
Whoever. How do you know they didn't have connection to the fucking Air Force?
Whoever these government officials were checking didn't have ties. There was no reports of Air Force officials going, and they wouldn't like
who's
why
that
would
coming
they go
from
and,
though? Who's that coming
this
from?
Is Colonel George P. Freeman.
That's what I don't understand is like the military groups are like coming out against each other being like, I don't know, this guy says a helicopter, this guy's fucking drunk. There's no helicopters. This guy says these are Air Force people. They're not fucking Air Force.
Well, they don't have as much cohesion as you'd think they would, right, Dan? As far as like military, like they don't really
like intelligence services don't necessarily have to tell the military what they need to know. There are you know, classifications above top secret, like that need to know kind of stuff. So, you know, if the CIA or something didn't want you to know about something, they just figure you don't need to know, especially back in the 60s, like they were doing whatever the fuck they want to do. So
even the other like military people, like you wouldn't, like you see it in the movies all the time. You know what I mean? The fucking feds show up and they're like, we got this. This is now our scene. We're taking over.
Well, that's law enforcement. So, but yeah, but, intelligence services don't necessarily, I mean, this could almost go into like the 9/11 stuff, but they don't really communicate all that well. There's not really open lines of communication between the CIA, NSA, you know, Homeland Security, now blah, blah, blah. They all kind of have their own purvey and their kind of own, agendas or objectives. And where they don't line up. They don't feel like they need to communicate certain things. So if a CIA was posing as an Air Force official and then they felt like this is something that the Air Force doesn't need to know about, or we don't need to really let them in on it, perhaps they didn't find anything, so they didn't feel like they needed to mention anything. Who knows?
Right.
But the Air Force doesn't necessarily, like, the CIA doesn't necessarily, is not obligated to tell the Air Force, like, we
see that. That would make more sense if you have some CIA people going in, right? Tell them you're Air Force, try to get accounts. Tell them not to talk to anyone else about your, like, that you're talking to them. Like, oh, no,
but
don't
why
talk
do you
about
even
this.
Have to lie? Why would you have to lie and say you're CIA? That's fucking good enough for me. This is what I fucking saw.
Well, that'd because be then weird. If it comes out, then it becomes, then it comes out like, say it's like the CIA was coming and asked, it's like, why the fuck does the CIA need to know? Wasn't this a helicopter? Right. What the fuck? Like, it, too many questions. So I could see something like that, but it's one of those things what gives this, I really, really like this case. Because of all the explanations, I lean right away to there was a UFO in the skies of New Jersey that night.
If different agencies are saying different things, say the military is just saying something to quell the public, and then intelligence comes in and says something to the military, like, don't tell them this. Maybe they already know it's something different, and it's just all quelling public fear. Because if right away, if you're like, especially back then, you're like in the middle of the Cold War, we have a UFO on American soil. It's has the ability to melt ice. Everyone would fucking lose their shit.
With a light.
Yeah, with a light.
Flashlight.
Melt a hole through your roof and abduct your children. Like, that's where the hysteria would go right away, probably.
And let's not forget that, like, so if a helicopter was over top, I forgot this too. It's causing the report, it was causing the water level to rise and all the treetops to bend together. Like, and collect underneath it. Like, that is...
Seems backwards of a helicopter, right?
Yeah.
If a helicopter...
Well, it seems like a helicopter should be flying all over the place.
Well, yeah, if a helicopter's in the middle of the reservoir, let's say...
Yeah, it'd be pushing the ice and the water away.
Yeah, if the ice wasn't very thick, it would probably crack the ice, and the wind would kind of push sideways, and maybe the trees would kind of start waving. But as far as, like, the eyewitness descriptions, everything's getting pulled to a center point. It seems like. So helicopters doesn't line up. So helicopter, no. weather balloon, atmospheric planet phenomena, something.
Swamp gas. Jupiter and Venus.
Yeah, all the classics.
In perfect alignment.
What else do we have? Is there any more theories of what it could be besides actually an UFO, unidentified ET craft?
The last one that kind of... may have fit the profile is a phenomenon known as light pillars. And I know a lot of people saw pictures of these just recently because it happens a lot in colder places, but I know a lot of people have seen them. It's usually it's an atmospheric optical phenomenon where you will observe what appears to be like a vertical beam of light, and it seems to extend far above its light source. But it can also go the other way. It can also look like it's coming down from a light source. So if you look up pictures of light pillars, you'll see a lot of photos, which could, you know, possibly be taken as or look like some type of UFO. They look like an object is projecting light down onto the ground. This happens when there is a reflection of light from tiny ice crystals, which are suspended in the atmosphere, which could have been, you know, in January, cold weather. I think cold weather is the ideal conditions.
Well, it's more northern. It's got to be north. You got to be northern. The more north you go, the more likely to see auroras and light pillars are.
Right. Now, I looked at light pillars, and I could agree that maybe the photo of this, and hashtag look it up, Wanaque UFO in photo. Yeah, sure. I could, you know what?
If it's one.
Potentially, this fits one aspect of this story. Where this loses me is the fact that there's so many accounts of this thing zigzagging, the flashing, the changing of the lights, you know. The changing of the colors. Light doesn't make trees bend together and water levels rise. Like, there's just so many other aspects. I would agree that, like, light pillars kind of explains away the one part, like the light pillars coming down from the lake or coming up, coming down.
I'm gonna crush the light pillars after you're done.
Crush
it. But you, so you don't, you, we can't explain the vacuum like effect that this, whatever is happening.
Yeah.
Crush them, Zell.
Yeah. The
crush
vacuum it. Effect, of course, is light pillars can't do that. But what you, if you look up light pillars, and they're usually more than one beam. Well, I think, and I, any picture I look at, there's at multiple beams. You know, six, right, eight, 10, 12. Right, that's coming from
multiple light sources. But if you have a singular light source, you don't have one beam.
It's probably pretty rare to see. It's pretty rare to see them below the 49th anytime. They have to be pretty powerful.
So, yeah. So, and the thing is like you also need a light source for it to happen. And what light source would be out in the middle of a frozen lake in the middle of January? I have no idea. So when you get beyond these explanations and you get beyond whatever you could call the mundane explanations of what this could actually be, if it were a UFO, you'd have to wonder as to what it was doing. If it's burning holes in the ice, you know, of course, these what appear to be intelligent patterns. We said before, perhaps it was searching for something. Like, what would it be searching for? First thing I thought of was that I remember seeing, and I can't remember if it's if it's the scene from the original cut or it's a deleted scene from E.T. And in the beginning of E.T., it implies that you have the scene or you have the shot of the E.T. creatures like coming out and actually like handling pine cones. Like they were looking for something, you know, where you have, there's this theory that, you know, aliens are looking for something, you know, whatever it is here on Earth. So perhaps, you know, water is something precious to them. We do know that a lot of a majority actually of UFO sightings occur near or on the water. You have tons of sightings of USOs, you know, unidentified submersible objects. You probably have more reports of those than you actually do have like of UFO events. You see a lot more of that. Water, sea or liquid water at least, seems to be a very, at least in our solar system, definitely seems to be kind of rare, except for, you know, at least, what is it, Enceladus?
Enceladus moon? Or Moon's not got it now?
Moon might have liquid water. We're not sure. But it large bodies of like, you know, liquid water seems to be rare, unless you take like Enceladus or whatever, but even then, you know, so perhaps it was there. Of course, you know, when they describe this craft, when I think about it, they describe this craft as very small. You know, it definitely isn't something that you would consider probably being manned or being, you know, controlled manually. It would probably be, something like a scout, or it'd be like some type of probe would make more sense, that it's searching for something, it's taking samples. Braden mentioned about it. Maybe it's just like some kind of like, perhaps like interdimensional probe, where it's like not necessarily sending it to another dimension, but it's reaching, it's looking for something, it's pulling it up, and then that it ports it, for lack of a better word, to another place. It ports it to its you know, its mothership, or, you know, its planet, wherever it's from. I mean, that would kind of make sense if you didn't need to send out a whole ship, if you could just send probes whipping through time and space, and you could just suck it up and then send it back easy. You know, that would be more simple than actually sending manned missions to these places, and definitely less dangerous. So that's what I think of, is that if it's perhaps, you know, that's kind of one of the things that I thought of, was that if it's looking for something, liquid water would be one of them. Why exactly it would be over the Wanaque, you know, reservoir, that's kind of anybody's guess. But
here's my thoughts on it. When I'm going to kind of go out there with this theory, this is one I was kind of thinking about earlier. From all the accounts, this one has the technology or whatever's flying doesn't, like, we could, if this was today, I would go, oh, maybe it's some sort of drone other than the light. We know we have like high powered light beams that, you know, that could potentially, you know, I don't know, instantaneously melt a hole in ice, but probably, you know, it's not out of the realm of possibilities for us now. to have some sort of drone that has, you know, flashing lights. I actually think that this specific encounter is potentially some sort of time travel device that we've created in the future.
Yes.
That we're sending back and we haven't quite. And the reason I think that is because of the effects of gravity around this of this craft, right? And we know that, you know, time travel, you know, maybe has something to do with gravity. We might be able to manipulate it that way. So maybe this is like, it affects the gravity in the area of where this thing is, because it doesn't fly. Like, the maneuvers aren't unbelievable maneuvers. They're just unbelievable for 1966. It's not that light speed. It's not that taking off. It's zigzags, sharp zigzags. But like, anyone knows, like, you know, if you could show someone from 1966, these like quadcopter drone races we have, in their minds would explode at these things, the movements and stuff that we can do now.
My mind explodes right now watching those quadcopter races. They're fucking insane.
So to me, I'm thinking that, you know, in the future, we do figure out time travel. And this is our own research drones going back and taking samples, whether molecular samples or something, just because we haven't perfected it. So it's like, did they mean to go to 1966 Wanaque Reservoir? Like, no, but that's where they popped up. They're like, all right, let's get some water. Let's get the hell out of there. Do our things. We're only going to be able to send it signals for 12 hours, and then we got to destroy it. We don't want to crash it on Earth because we don't want people to collect it. Maybe it's something like that.
Right. So you're going, that kind of goes with the theory that, like, when people say like alien greys are like, they're like more like androids.
Yeah.
And so some people say like, that's us in the future sending stuff back. Like those drones, like that. So we're sending back Android drones in like drone craft back through time. And this could just be like a smaller version of those, like a drone craft, like some type of collecting whatever. Wherever they send it, it collects whatever's around.
Here's what I'm saying is that if in fact we are, or the grays are sending stuff back in time, it's not going to be linear. So maybe this probe in 1966, maybe this is like the first wave of things sent back in time, right? And then, you know, we see stuff, you know, in 1947, we have the Roswell crash. Maybe that's more advanced technology from even further in the future, but they've just sent it back further in time. You know what I mean? Like,
right.
We would not see the linear progression of their time travel devices. It wouldn't matter.
So someone from the year, whatever, let's say like year 3000 sends a craft back, it gets back to 1966, but then someone from the year 4000 sends a craft back, it goes back to 47.
Yeah. Or even, yeah, right. Exactly. Like, it's just the technology is getting better, but we would never see the linear progression of these devices. Well, if in fact that's what it is.
Yeah. If you perfected time traveling, you could actually jump between time. Yeah. You would have no idea. Like, you could get something from who knows how far in the future to come back, or you could get something just from 100 years right now. When we just first discover it, the only thing we can send back is a little drone that flashes and melts ice.
Yeah.
I mean, the light is way too small to be a DeLorean, so I call bullshit.
Fair.
But that's my theory.
Now, I'm waiting for the time when a gigantic robot comes out of that lake. And in 66, that was when it activated. This robot's been lying here for God knows how long, just like War of the Worlds. Comes down, aliens. Yeah, they shoot the aliens through the crust of the ice into the ship. They're just sitting there dormant, waiting for the right time, and then it's just going to pop through the top of the ice.
Didn't hear the sound, so that means no giant robots, right?
Not yet. They're lying dormant. They were shot down in a cryogenic tube where they're just waiting for the signal from whatever, the homeland, the mothership, and then they're going to start breaking through. We'll see.
That's a good movie.
Great movie. Also probable.
It's underrated.
I liked it. I liked it a lot.
Andrew, did you have a theory?
Well, not so much as far as I don't like any of these explanations personally. I don't buy any of them. You know what I mean? But again, my knowledge on weather balloons and silent helicopters is very limited. But for me, like, I, you know, it's hard to it's hard to think that it could be anything else. You know what I mean? Like at first I kind of thought maybe it could be like somebody using a spotlight or something like that, or potentially maybe a firework. You know what I mean? Given the timing, it's January 11th. I could imagine people, you know what I mean?
On the leftover 31st
from Christmas, right? Maybe they're shooting off a few cool Roman candles or something like that. But I feel like out in that entire city, it would be hard to fool all those people. Somebody's going to recognize a fucking firework.
Well, no firework stands in the air for that long.
Yeah.
Without sound.
Exactly, right? Maybe, so then, you know, but like that's my first thoughts were maybe it was a spotlight, maybe it was a firework potentially, but no, I don't like any of those, especially with, you know what I mean? Especially with the vacuumous effect that it has on the environment around it and the holes in the ice. Like,
see, that's why it almost makes like a singularity around it. It seems like where, you know, it's the gravity is pulling towards it. That's why I'm thinking some sort of like dimensional craft, and we can see the effects on our physical, but we can't perceive everything that it's doing.
Yeah, it could very well be. I don't know. This is far above my pay grade. I have no fucking clue.
It's displacing time. It's just displacing gravity. Just like Bob Lazar said, those crafts will displace gravity around them, and that's how they travel.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe. Dan, what do you think?
Yeah, sure. If the best way you're going to be traveling through space is, you know, punching holes in space and time. Like, it's the quickest way to get from point A to point B. So, from our understanding of the universe so far, science has told us that, you know, gravity has a lot to do, gravity, electromagnetic forces, whatever. It's probably going to be some type of propulsion based on that. So, that's your best case, some advanced propulsion off of that. I mean, our most advanced propulsion at this point is like setting off nuclear bombs behind a, you know, setting off a nuclear bomb inside a chamber and then using that to propel our stuff. It's basically just a big bullet, but
we're basically the gun planet.
Yeah.
Like everything we do is basically you're just shooting a bullet.
No wonder they're only sending fucking probes, drones and shit. They don't want to land here. They don't want anything to do with
point B.
No, I like this one. It's cool. Like, I didn't see a movie. I don't see any book deals. I don't see anything like that. Like, it's fucking, nobody's profiting off of it.
It's honestly not talked about enough, in my opinion.
I had not heard about it till we looked it up just this last week. And
excellent case file, Dan. Dan suggested it.
Dan did suggest it. And let's just quickly touch on that. It was in January was the initial sighting, but it actually came back the following October. Isn't that right, Dan?
Yeah, there was another a couple reported sightings in October in the same place. This was reported by Robert J. Gordon of Pompton Lakes, which you guys recall is near Wanaque. That him and his wife Betty actually saw this saucer shaped object, and they reported it being the size of an automobile, being the size of a car, and then also glowing white. So, you know, maybe it was the mothership coming back to check out what the probe had found or something like that. But it was described being extremely bright. One person at least described it as being, you know, as bright as like when a light bulb is going to blow. So this thing was, you know, blinding at some point, yeah. I suppose. But yeah, it's, I don't know. It seems that this thing even has the ability to change shape, because you have some people saying it looked like a sphere, looked like a basketball, or it looked like the almost a traditional, like saucer shape and things like that, with the little dome or cupola, whatever you want to call it, on top. But yeah, it's, you know, apparently it came back in October. So Wanaque was kind of just chock full of UFOs for that year.
It's cool.
Should we get into a little bit space news?
There we go.
Basically, hell exists. Confirmed.
Yeah, we all learned that in 2020.
Yeah. Hell exists.
It's here on Earth.
It's here on Earth. Well, there is a worse place to be on 2020. This planet K2-141b is worse. It's basically The floor's lava everywhere. Oceans of lava, winds that reach supersonic speeds, and the rain is made of rock. It rains rocks. And it's one of the most extreme environments ever discovered. So it's very interesting. It flies very close to its sun, and it's just a lava planet. It's, very bizarre. Rains rocks.
Sounds great.
This is an interesting one. NASA finally contacted. Oh, and we get all these from most of the space news we get from sciencealert.com. Great website for getting space news. That's sponsor where most us. Of these are from. Sponsor us.
Sponsor us.
NASA finally makes contact with the Voyager 2 after the longest radio silence in 30 years.
That's crazy.
I didn't know this. There's basically only one satellite
that
can talk.
There's only one
dish.
Yeah.
That's powerful enough to communicate with Voyager 2, which is currently over 8.7 billion kilometers away, or 11.6 billion miles.
Well, it's also the best one because the way that Voyager is heading outside of our solar system, or the way that it's kind of orientated with the Earth's orientation to the sun, or how we orbit, it generally moves in like a more southerly direction. So it would be difficult for like a northern hemisphere one to get it, but it's easy for the Australian one to get it.
Because that thing's like in the Oort cloud now, isn't it? It's well past. It's like way the fuck out there.
I don't even know if it's in the Oort cloud. I think there's still some distance to go, but it's far out there. It's past Pluto.
It's far out, man. That's pretty far out, man.
And it works. It works perfectly well. That's the crazy thing. It's like this thing has been traveling forever, and they're like, "Yeah, it works. Like it works perfectly fine. There's nothing wrong with it."
They hadn't communicated with it for 11 months because they were doing critical upgrades to the Deep Space Station 43 in Australia, which is the only antenna that can send commands. They sent it commands. It responded. It executed the commands without issue.
What did
I don't
it say?
Know.
This is fucking important
it's
information.
Getting dark.
I don't know.
I think it was a protocol that just like it executes and then it to indicate that it received that message. It's just like you send it to them. It's like, did you get this? And it says, yes, I got this. Beep.
No, what's so crazy about that probe is say it goes for another like hundreds and hundreds of years and it stays operational. It's eventually going to get to a point where it's closer to a different sun. And fire, and it's going to be able to power back up because eventually it's going to get too far away from our sun that it'll just run out of juice. There won't be enough light to feed it. But eventually, because once you're going at that speed, there's no stopping you until you get picked up by a different gravity from a different sun or something. So eventually that thing's going to get to a point where it fires back up again in a different solar system. I don't know if it'll have enough juice to get all the way back to Earth, but eventually it'll start trying to send signals again. It's fucking nuts.
Could you imagine we pick up something like the Voyager 2, but incoming?
Oh.
Right? Just a simple, and you're just like, holy shit, that'd be wild.
It's possible.
Anyways, Elon Musk wants to impose his own regime on Mars. Basically, he wants to be Mars dictator. Mars ambassador.
I read that. I thought it was a joke at first.
Minister of Mars.
Basically, they want to draft their own constitution for Mars.
Earth laws will not apply.
It's only a matter of time before he becomes a supervillain. Only a matter of time.
So yeah, this article is actually really interesting because it talks about space law, which is the thing. And I didn't know that really until I read this article that you can specialize in space law. You can become a lawyer of space law. Like
not a lot of openings.
Yeah. What have I done with my life? That's what I should have been.
But there is an original like space treaty that was written like 1967, 1966 or something there where most like at least 100 countries and all of the spacefaring ones that have signed on to it, where essentially for right now, when a citizen of Earth, you know, a citizen of a country on Earth goes into space, they carry their citizenship with them. So you are still subject to the laws of your country.
Right.
And that includes corporations as well. So SpaceX is still subject, and its liability lies with the United States because it's a United States, it's a U.S. company. So if something were to happen and then it violated some international law or it violated another country's sovereignty or something within, you know, in the area or something like that, the United States would be liable for that, not the company itself.
I mean, it makes sense. Like if there's bird law, there should be fucking space law.
So, but right? But then it does raise the question. It's like when you know, for right now, it's like enforcing law in space is not like that big a deal, because it's like the only place that people live outside of Earth is on the ISS, and it's like what, like 9 people or something, like 7 or 9 people in there. But yeah, if they go live on Mars, where it's like a 2-year trip, like to get there?
How long something does it take like to get there? Like a year to get there at least, yeah.
Yeah. So it's like executing law there would be a bit problematic, you know. I probably, I don't know, I'll be head in a jar or something. But if we live to see the first murder on Mars, you know, that's going to be a big thing. Or the first person born on Mars, like, are you a citizen of the country that your parents are from, or are you a citizen, sovereign citizen of Mars?
You believe,
so you're telling me that space has more laws than international waters?
I suppose so. I mean, you know,
can you have diplomatic immunity on Mars?
No, because you're not a diplomat, but you know, if you're born it'd be strange, but it's not like something this hasn't been thought of before. You know, this is one of the things, like, you know, do you fall under the company? So is it going to become like an outer, if anybody's played the Outer Worlds games, like if you play the Outer Worlds, like, is it going to become that the company owns you? You are a property of the company because they put you on the planet and they provide for you. You know, so it's like, you know, you've tried the rest, now try the best, SpaceX. And you have to put that after, that's your daily mantra in the morning, you know, whatever. So, it brings up a lot of complicated questions about people living on Mars and what are we going to do when people get over there? Who enforces laws and whose laws do they follow? You know, is it, you know, cryogenically frozen head of Elon Musk when they get there? Like, I don't know.
Well, it makes sense. You're on a different planet. How are someone on Earth going to enforce law on that planet?
Sure. I mean, we have a whole book series, The Expanse. It's like, that's the whole thing is like pretty much like, you know, a planet, not necessarily companies, but you have a whole planet founded over there. And it's, you know, first it's types of countries, or is it going to be companies, private companies, things like that. I think Total Recall has some stuff about that too. But, you know, the concept is not new, but it does bring up when it actually happens, like, it's going to be interesting to see.
Yeah. I mean, if you can look on this on Science Alert for this article, and you can see the projected space colony that Elon wants to put up. It like starts with this like a simple like couple of towers, and all of a sudden there's like a fucking Mars metropolis. It's like, this is what I want. There's like hundreds and hundreds of
simulation, or that's a game. I think I've seen a game like that before. I think that's like colonizing Mars, the game.
Well, maybe. It's titled Base Buildup, and what they think would happen on Mars and how fast it would go if they actually started.
Yeah, you've got like a set of, you know, rocket launch pads, and then those extend out into the, you know, extend out into the cities where they start building the colony.
Bunch of bubble domes with like little tunnels connecting all the buildings and stuff.
Their projections are pretty cool. Like, you know, when they're building this, the Project Starship or whatever, they're building this entire, you know, stainless steel rocket ship, which is intended to be like 100% reusable.
And Planet Express.
Yeah. Essentially. Yeah. That's what it looks like, you know, good news, everybody. We're driving down the price of space travel. You know, it's like half of you will die on Mars, but that's okay. Won't affect the bottom line.
That's all I had for space news. Why don't we, is the randomatron working?
I got it working. Oiled up, lubed up, ready to go.
Perfect. Let's fire that sucker up.
Let's hear it. Coming. guys getting that across the globe here? Four points in North America. Still hear shit on my sleep.
Here's shit on my face. Shit on my sleeve.
Here's shit in my sleep, but yeah, shit on your sleeve.
I hear shit on your face.
That happens too.
Let us know what you hear.
There's poop everywhere. It's not good.
All right.
Lots of bodily fluids.
Mongoose file, baby.
So as we know at the beginning of these things, you know, this happens to a friend of a friend of a friend of mine. But in order to get this story across, it's a little easier to, you know, put it in the first person.
Yeah.
Just flows nicer, right? So, like the majority of these, they take place in a coastal town. You know what I mean? Somewhat like, I don't know, BC, we could say.
West Coast,
a
BC.
Coastal BC city. Yeah, West Coast. Beautiful. Big place.
Vancouver, Tropolis. Maybe.
Yeah, Vancouver's sure. Good. You know, that there we go. We'll go with that. Similar to Vancouver. Yeah. Sounds good. So, routine night shift, you know. Not a night like any other night. Nothing standing out. Nothing crazy. Call comes in. It's approximately 3:30 in the morning. Call comes on the CAD. Unresponsive 5-week-old baby.
No.
You know? And a lot of those, unfortunately, after you've done the job for a while, a lot of those calls, they come in and, you know, they're normally, you know, they're new parents, right? They've only had the kid for 5 weeks, and a lot of these are usually overreactions, right? Baby's been apneic or hasn't, you know, breathed for, a scary amount of time. Parents kind of overreact, call 911, and by the time the ambulance gets there, everything's fine. Baby's smiling or crying or, you know, otherwise healthy. So we respond to this call. Apartment complex. You know what I mean? Nothing, no red flags. Everything seems quite normal. Knock on the door and there's an air of nonchalance because, you know, it's quite common. You bring the necessary equipment though, but you know, for the majority of these things, that's usually nothing. So bang on the door, so-and-so ambulance service, door flies open and immediately there's a blue, limp, 5 month or 5 week old child thrust into our friend of a friend of ours chest. So right off the bat, you're like, okay, fuck, shit's real. So look over at my partner. I'm like, we need the BVM right now. Hook it up with some O2.
It's a BVM.
I'm going to bag valve mask. That's what we use to assist respirations if somebody's in respiratory arrest or struggling to breathe. You know, you could just give supplemental oxygen if there was some sort of respiratory drive, but she has no respiratory drive. So we had to breathe for her.
Right.
And in that case, you use the bag valve mask. So we start bagging this baby right away. You notice, you know what? She's got a heart rate. It's tachycardic, which means her heart rate's very fast. She's cyanotic, which means she's blue, which means she's been hypoxic without oxygen for a while. So we start bagging her and right away look over to the parents like, what's going on? You know, is baby healthy? Has anything happened? Could she have possibly choked on something? Auscultate, you know what I mean? Air is going in and out nicely. So right away, you know, it doesn't sound like there's any obstructions. Mom goes, hey, no, baby's healthy. You know, nothing, you know, abnormal, regular pregnancy, regular birth. Okay. Check the blood sugar. You know what I mean? That's normal, you know, and it's just so confusing because the baby, you know, normally, you know, you'd think they would be in cardiac arrest by now, but they're just in respiratory arrest. Heart rate's nice and strong. So we're sitting there and you could see the mom kind of just, you know, she's panicking, but she can't move very well. And I'm like, you know, you said everything was normal. You know, could you have potentially, like, you know what I mean? The birth was normal. She's like, yeah, it was a C-section. Everything went fine. Oh, it was a C-section. She's like, yes. So I'm like, okay. Interesting. Like, was baby breech, anything like that? No. Just was an emergency C-section. Okay. And, you know, me and my partner are kind of looking back at each other being like, obviously we need ALS here to intubate this baby, but like, what the fuck is going on? And you're sitting here and thinking, and I'm like, you know, C-section, it was only 5 weeks ago. Are you taking anything for pain? She's like, yeah, you know, the doctors prescribed me Tylenol. And I'll be honest with you, the pain's been quite unbearable. So I've been taking some meds that I've had for a previous injury.
Mm.
Okay, go get those meds. Go get those fucking meds right now. And the father comes running up to us and he's got two pill containers. And you look at him and one is Tramadol and the other is Oxycontin.
What's Tramadol?
Tramadol is a opioid-based analgesic painkiller.
Oh, shit.
So it's an opioid mixed with an acetaminophen, if I might be wrong, but I'm pretty sure it's
something like that.
An opioid with acid. So right away, I'm like, you know what I mean? It's baby breastfed. She's like, yes, baby's breastfed. And I look at my partner, I'm like, draw me up some Narcan right now. We had to look up the dose. It's not every day that you give a 5-week-old Narcan, right?
Right.
It's a little bit abnormal. So we had to look up the dosages and, you know, we're Narcanning this child. And just as we're doing that, ALS arrives and they're like, what the fuck are you doing? We're like, listen, kid's in respiratory arrest.
That advanced life support.
Mom's breastfeeding. She's been eating opioids like M&Ms, like she said. So we're gonna give her some Narcan. And he's like, yeah, go for it. And within 2 minutes, baby's pink and screaming. And yeah, her breast milk was giving her potent. The opioid. Oh. Usually it's a small dose, but with the amount she was eating, I guess it was enough to make the child have an opioid overdose. It's just crazy bizarre.
Just from like the small body size of the infant with the mother's breast milk was enough to OD the baby.
Which is wild.
Holy shit.
Yeah, man. It was crazy. And it's just like, it's just not something you would ever think about. You know what I mean? Like, it was just such a random thought that popped up and it's like, it's weird that she's limping and not looking like, you know what I mean? Like, weird. And then just, it's cool. You get to do a little Sherlocking every once in a while. It's
wild. That is
pretty cool.
That's some good intuition.
Yeah.
On a friend of a friend.
Well, you have to, man, because you panic, right? You're like, fuck, what the hell is causing this? Nothing makes sense. You know, with
not choking, with kids, not nothing, just, but still blue.
And the wild part about that is, I'm not exaggerating. 99.9% of these calls with these infants is nothing because, you know what I mean? You're just, you don't know what the fuck
parents.
You're doing. I've been there. It's terrifying, man. Like, I sit there staring at my kid in the middle of the night being like, holy fuck, his chest hasn't moved. Like, is he breathing? Is he, you know what I mean? Like, you panic. It's terrifying.
Well, I don't know what you mean because I don't know, but I could imagine.
Yeah, it's terrifying.
That's crazy. Yeah.
Baby's happy and healthy. I think she's almost 1 year old now. But yeah, anyways.
Whew.
It's the mongoose file for the
mongoose file.
Terrifying.
Let's give out a theorite of the week. I think this week we're going to give it to, I don't know, think he's ever got it before, but he's been a long time community member, a long time fan of the show, Steven Estep.
And a step,
two P's. But he made
a guy's just a everlasting presence on social media.
Dude, he's unreal. He just made a post of like, how'd you just in the Facebook group, like, how'd you guys find ATT? And it got like massive response. And I went and read all the comments. Most of them was like, I searched for alien and these idiots popped up and I never left. Like, awesome. But Steven Estep, this week's Theorite of the Week. Thanks for being a great member of the community and keeping the conversation going. Over the last 6-8 months, this place is goldmine. I'm in there every day now. I love it.
Yeah. It used to be toxic and now it's great. Like this was the first time, I don't know how long, that I've seen an Epstein meme.
Yeah.
This is the first time
tasteful
one
ones
up.
Too. They're tasteful.
Yeah.
Tasteful memes. But Steven Estep, Theorite of the Week. We appreciate it. All right. If you've not got on our Patreon yet and you want to get extended versions of these case files, the live versions with the after hours, bonus content and all the rest, Discord access, head over to patreon.com/alientheoristspodcast. This week's patrons going with, this is a new one. How do you describe this? Bracket squiggle underscore squiggle bracket neutral face happy face Kyle Cody Dixon Nathan Matlock
Ooh, that's a great show.
Great fucking show.
My grandma loved that fucking show.
Gary Bennett, Jordan Sutton, Joellen, Jacob Bowden, Martin Stolp, Jacqueline Wright, Nathan, Blake Cates, Matthew, Alana Halawi, Emily Scoradato. Welcome back. We recognize the name. Gone for a bit. Now she's back. We appreciate it. Matthew Andralowicz, Trent Gioa. I think I might have read that last week. And Sawyer Das. This week's patrons, we support. We thank you for the support. And I think that's all. That's all for me this week. Anything else?
And as we always say at the end of these things, keep those eyes on the skies.
See you on After Hours.